Thank you. Thanks for singing with us this morning. You may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the 10:15 service here at Corinth. My name is Luke. I'm one of the ministers here on staff, and we're glad you're here. If you're in the room, it's good to see you. If you're joining us online, thanks for tuning in. Glad to have you with us as well. Hey, if you're a guest and you're visiting us for the first time this morning, I want to say a special welcome to all of you. Thank you so much for being here this morning. We would love to connect with you. There's a couple of ways that we can do that. There's a card in the seat back in front of you that says new here. You can pull that out, fill it out, and then drop it in the bucket as it's passed by later on in the service. Or you can pull out your phone, go over to corinth.cc. There you can click I'm new, fill that out. We'll connect with you that way. We'd also love to meet you this morning. And so after the service is over, if you head out those double doors and over to the guest services kiosk, someone will be there to greet you, shake your hand, and give you a gift. Our way of saying means the world that you're with us this morning. Thanks for being here. We are a church that wants to lead generations to follow Jesus together. And so we're going to meet for about an hour together this morning. We're going to have some more worship. We're going to take communion together. And then you'll hear a sermon from our senior minister, Adam Turner, who is going on with week 3 of Keep It Positive. If you did miss week 1 or week 2, you can always check back online to get caught up. But we're excited about what he has to say with us this morning. So you came on a good Sunday. I don't know if you know this or not. Probably you do. NFL football kicks off. This is the first Sunday. How many of you guys are excited about that? Right? Football is like totally in full swing right now. And it reminds me of this question. How many Florida freshman football players does it take to change a light bulb? None. That's a sophomore level class over there. Yeah? You like that one? Good. Hey, we are excited about football. I know many of you are as well, but we're even more excited about some of the things that are going on here at Corinth. So pull out your bulletin or go over to corinth.cc so that you can sign up for things like Financial Peace University, a marriage class, or a new women's Bible study. You can do all of those things there. I want to highlight two things for you. Trunk or Treat is approaching. It will be here sooner than we know, and we're excited about that. We're going to go ahead and start collecting candy now. And so out in the concourse, as you kind of go out the doors on the left, you'll notice a bunch of barrels and a sign that says candy. We want to invite you and ask you to participate with us by going ahead and bringing in some candy over the next several weeks so that we can get going with Trunk or Treat preparations. We're excited to see what happens about that. Also, our Next Steps events, we want to continue to highlight that. Right after this service at 11:30 in Founders Hall, we are having our Start Here event. And so if you signed up or you didn't sign up, feel free to come on out, join us for lunch, and figure out what this church is all about and how you can get plugged in and connected here. We want to see you there. For everything else, check out social media, check out corinth.cc, check out your bulletin. Give it a good look over so that you don't miss out on anything that you want to be a part of. Here's what I want to do. I want to pray, and then we'll continue on with our service this morning. God, thank you for gathering us here this morning. We are so grateful for the way that you work in our lives each and every week. God, I pray that as we sit under your word this morning, that our hearts would be open and our minds would be attentive to the way that you are going to continue to lead us closer to you. I pray that our response to all that you do for us would be to turn our minds and hearts towards you and to lift you up and praise you for who you are. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Across the Here I empty myself to all. So much that we have the opportunity to come together and worship you as one body. Lord, I pray that we are filled up today, that as we hear your words, that we are emboldened to go out through this week to pour ourselves out to others, that we would be that light, that city on a hill to a world that needs you so, so badly. Lord God, help us to be confident in you. Amen.
Football team is down 5 points. They have a few seconds left on the clock, really only time for one more play. They did a little bit of a drive, but they didn't quite make it to the red zone, so they're at the opposing team's 45-yard line around that area. And you know the play that they have to call. It's a Hail Mary. And so the quarterback calls the play. They come out of the huddle. He snaps the ball. Receivers run all the way down to the field into the end zone where the defensive backs are already waiting for them. There's not much action going on at the line of scrimmage because there's only two or three defenders trying to get past the offensive line to the quarterback, and they can handle that pretty well. And so the quarterback rolls off to the right a little bit, takes a step into the hardest throw he's ever done, and it launches into the air, way up, way high, going a long ways, in hopes that a miracle is going to happen, in hopes that a receiver might just come down with the ball in the end zone to win the game. I don't know if you know this or not, but if you're familiar with a Hail Mary football play, what it communicates is desperation. This is a last resort. This is everything that we're going to give a shot to. We need something miraculous to happen because we're desperate. Sometimes we can find ourselves in times of desperation, in time of need, and we can almost wait or expect or anticipate a miracle to happen. But each week, we take communion together. We take the Lord's Supper. We eat the bread that represents Jesus' body, and we drink the juice that represents his blood. And it's a chance to remember that while we might have times of desperation, the miracle has already happened. And it happened in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And we should be confident in that. That no matter what time of need we find ourselves in, no matter what desperation we are longing for, that God is working on our behalf and that Jesus took our place on the cross so that we might have forgiveness and salvation when we needed it the most. And so in a moment, as these things are passed, I hope and pray that will be something you are encouraged by and that you can't help but want to be united with Christ because of this. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this time. We pray that we just ask that we would be united with you because of these things, and that you would bless this time, and that you would bless us, and that we wouldn't stay the same because of this specific time that we take in the service. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, here in just a moment, our guys are going to pass around some buckets and give us all a chance to be able to give. But before we do that, I want to give a real quick shout out to Jeremy and Jenny Carnes. Jeremy, our worship minister, and Jenny, our early childhood director. This past week marked 5 years, their five-year anniversary with us here at Corinth Christian Church. We are all incredibly grateful that they followed God's leading and his calling, and we're thankful that God called them here to serve alongside of us. So if you get a chance, give them a attaboy, attagirl. Let them know you're glad that they're a part of the team. We'll be receiving our offerings now. This is a chance for us to just be able to support what God is doing here. We know a lot of you all have already done that online. For that, we say thanks. But this is just a chance to do that here in person. If you've got cards, whether it's I'm New, communication, decision cards, serve cards, any of those kind of things, you can drop those cards off in these buckets. Thank you so much for your generosity. It allows us to lead generations to follow Jesus together. So thank you so very much. Let me pray. And we'll receive, then we'll do some preaching. God, we love you. We thank you that you are a good God who loves us, who provides for us, and takes care of our needs. And so as we bring our tithes and offerings before you, we ask that you would use those here at Corinth, to lead generations to follow you. Give us wisdom as we use these, and please bless the giver. And God, as we turn our attention to the scriptures now, we pray that you give us ears to hear what you have to say. Please help me to say what you would have me to say. Keep me from saying things I shouldn't today. And would you lead us in this time together. And we pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Adam, and I'm the senior minister here at Corinth Christian Church. If you're a guest, I want to say welcome. Thank you so much for coming in to join us today. I would love a chance to meet you. If we've never had a chance to say hello, I would love a chance to do that. So I'm going to be hanging out at the guest service kiosk, which is just straight ahead out those doors there. I would love a chance to shake your hand and put a gift in your hand as well, because it really does mean the world to us that you're here. So please stop on by after services today. I also want to say hello to our friends who are watching us online. We hope you're having a good day wherever you find yourself. We know most people check us out online before they ever step foot in here, and so we hope we'll see you here in person real soon. But I think next Sunday would be a great Sunday to be your first Sunday with us here in person. So let's do what we can to make that happen. Well, today we are going to continue on in our series that's called Keep It Positive. Everybody say that with me? Keep it positive. You know, because the idea is this, is that negativity and cynicism are so easy to find in this world. And so we're just kind of asking the question, how can we keep it positive in a negative world? And today, we're just going to call today's message this, I'm confident. Okay, that's how we're going to be positive, is by being confident. So everybody just say, I'm confident with me. I'm confident. Now say it again like you are confident. I'm confident. That's right. We are talking about confidence. Reminds me of the story I heard about a little boy from the Atlanta area. His family, they ended up moving down to the New Orleans area. And his first week of school, and little boy's in class, and the teacher's going around and saying, hey, we just want to kind of know who all is in the classroom together. So she said, let's talk about football. How many of y'all are New Orleans Saints fans? And so everybody's hand in that room goes up except for that one little boy. And she's like, well, little boy, what's wrong with you? I mean, why aren't you a Saints fan? He goes, well, ma'am, I am an Atlanta Falcons fan, okay? That's who I cheer for. He's like, well, why do you do that? He's like, well, my daddy's a Falcons fan. My mama's a Falcons fan. So I'm a Falcons fan. And so the teacher says, well, what if your daddy was a moron and your mama was stupid? Well, what would you be? He goes, well, I guess, ma'am, I'd be a Saints fan, right? Yeah, there we go. Happy NFL opening day, right? There we go. That's confidence right there. That's boldness to be able to stand in the midst of everybody else, the enemy, and to say, here's who I am for. We're talking about confidence. You know, confidence is a really important thing for us. And one of the things that happens is a lot of us struggle to find it. And we struggle to find confidence. And what we do is we wrestle with insecurity. We wrestle with a lack of certainty, with uncertainty. We question our abilities to do what really needs to be done. We wonder, and we're uncertain about our future, our relationship with God. We're unsure and insecure around other people. Can I be real with you for just a second? I'm going to be no matter what, so you don't have to give me permission, but I'm going to be real with you for just a second here. I wrestle with this from time to time. Most of the time, my confidence is fairly good, but there are times in these moments when I just find myself and I wrestle with insecurity. Am I really a good enough dad? You know, men, maybe you wrestle with that. You know, I've got a son, he'll graduate this year, daughter will graduate in 2 years. It's like, oh my goodness, have I done enough as a dad to pour myself into them and prepare them for who they're going to become? I wrestle as a husband. It's just like, am I a good enough husband? My wife's amazing. Am I a good enough husband for her? Do I treat her the way that Christ would treat the church? And I wrestle, guys, honestly, I wrestle a lot of times, like, am I a good enough pastor? Am I a good enough preacher for Corinth? Am I the guy that this church needs? I wrestle with those things. Maybe you understand that. You know, dads, moms, we just wrestle and it's just like, we doing enough? We look at our relationship with our spouses or friends, like, am I good enough? Or we look at our jobs, it's just like, do I have what it takes? And we wrestle with insecurity. Maybe it's not about that. Maybe it's, you know, around like how you look. And maybe you look in the mirror and you're just not happy with what you look like. You're like, man, if I was just a little thinner, you know, if I had just a little bit more muscle, if I had just, you know, better hair, or at least hair in the right spots, not the wrong spots. You know, if I could just fix these 47 things about myself, then I would be happy with how I look. And we just find ourselves just wrestling with this anxiety, wrestling with this insecurity, wrestling with this uncertainty. We just don't have any confidence. And then to make matters worse is we are our own worst enemy. And we say the worst things to ourselves, right? I mean, nobody talks to you like you do. You're just a phony. You're just a fake. People really knew you, they wouldn't want to have anything to do with you. Who do you think you are? And we just wrestle with this insecurity and it just grabs a hold of us. And the problem is that whenever we are insecure, and what insecurity does and this uncertainty does is it just holds us captive. And so it keeps us from taking the steps that we feel like God wants us to take. It holds us captive with this uncertainty, and we're afraid to just take the risk, to step out into faith, and to do what we feel like God is leading us to do. And so this uncertainty is like, oh, I can't take that job. I can't take that. I don't know that I can do that. Or it's like, I can't go back to school. That's what other people do. You know, I can't get in shape. I mean, it's just too far. I'm too far gone. I can't do this anymore. I can't ask her out. I mean, there's no way that she would ever say yes to me. You know, I can't lead a small group. I mean, how can I lead a small group? Somebody might ask a question or something like that. How am I can't volunteer. I can't work with kids. And we just allow ourselves to just, with this lack of confidence, this uncertainty, just keeps us away from stepping out and living the life that God wants us to live. So today, what I want to do is I want to give you some confidence. I want to just infuse you with confidence, but I'm not talking about self-confidence today. I don't want you to just be more confident in yourself. I'm talking about, I want you to learn to be God confident. In fact, that's the bottom line this morning is this. I'm not self-confident. I am God confident. In fact, let's say that together. I'm not self-confident. I'm God confident. Say it again like you believe it. I'm not self-confident. I'm God confident. That's where we're going to find our confidence. That's where we're going to find our strength. I want you to listen to what the prophet Jeremiah says in Jeremiah chapter 17, starting off in verse 7. He says these words, "But blessed is the one who," say it with me, "who trusts in the Lord," who, say it, "his confidence is in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought, and it never fails to bear fruit. The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it?" I love this. It's like, blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, not who trusts in his own self, but whose confidence is in the Lord. It's not about me. It's not about my strength. It's not about my capabilities or my abilities. It's not my strength, but his. And why isn't it about me? Why isn't it about my strength? Why isn't it about my heart? Because my heart is deceitful. In fact, some of the worst advice that you can ever give somebody, and maybe you've done this before, today I'm encouraging you to stop, okay? The worst advice you can ever give or ever hear is just follow your heart. That's a bad idea. That's a terrible idea. You want to know why it's a terrible idea? Because your heart is deceitful. It lies to you. It's deceitful above all things. Who can even understand it? Whose heart can you trust? Not yours, God's. You can trust his heart, not yours. His heart is not deceitful. And we know this, and our heart is deceitful. Our spirit is willing, our flesh is weak. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. I am not self-confident. I am God-confident. Now, I want to say this up front. I want to give you a real quick clarification. I'm not telling you there's anything wrong with having a little bit of self-confidence. Okay, so don't walk out of here thinking that. That's not what I'm saying. You know, if you're saying to yourself, you know what, God gave me these gifts, God gave me these abilities, so therefore I can go do it, there is nothing wrong with that at all. There's nothing wrong with that at all. What I am saying is that if you truly want to max out, and if you truly want to live a life that completely glorifies God, you will never do it relying on your own self, your own strength, your own confidence in yourself. You will do it by developing a God confidence is how you will live a life that is maxed out to his glory. So today, I just want to give you three reasons, three ways to kind of grow self-confidence, God confidence in your life, to be able to just grow this, to cultivate this in your life. Three true statements. The first thing is this, is that we can be confident. I am confident because God is my helper. God is my helper. I can have confidence in this. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, this is what the writer says. Says, God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with, say the word with me, we say with confidence. We're saying this with confidence. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. For what can mere mortals do to me? We say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. Several years ago, I had a car that the polite way to put it is a piece of junk. Okay, there are other ways to say it, not in a pulpit, but that is just what this car was. It was a piece of, it was a 2000 Kia Sophia. It was a light green color, looked like something a teenage girl would drive around. I drove it around, all right? That's what it was. And whenever I say it was a piece of junk, it was a piece of junk because it was the kind of car that the air conditioner would only kick on if I would go over a speed bump really hard, all right? It was the kind of car that if I drove it for 20 minutes and then I parked, if I walked into a store for 5 minutes or so and came back out, it wasn't going to restart, okay? I would just have to walk around a store for 20 to 25 minutes to let it cool down so it would actually start again. In fact, I remember one time I went to a hospital to go see somebody, drove all the way, you know, 45 minutes or so to the hospital, pulled into the parking spot, went up to the front desk. They're like, sorry, they're not here. So I went and sat in my car for 25 minutes. And then I had to pay $5, you know, for the parking because I was at the wrong hospital because it wouldn't start back up. It was a piece of junk, okay? And it had all kinds of things wrong with it. But one of the major problems it had is it went through alternators like nobody's business. I owned that car for several years. I know we replaced the alternator at least four times in that, maybe even more than that. Might have been 37. I don't even remember. But here's what you need to know about me. I am not a mechanic. Okay, that is not my strength. That is not my ability. That is one of those things that is a weakness of mine, and it is a frustration of mine. You know, I can open up the hood and look in there and go, flat tire. You know, that's pretty much what the problem is right now. So I don't know. And alternators are expensive to replace. And especially on this car, because the way to get to the alternator is you had to remove the passenger side headlight, and then you had to unhook the engine from the chassis, jack the engine up to actually be able to get to the alternator. So it was a really expensive fix, and I didn't want to do a really expensive fix. Why? It was a 2000 Kia Sophia, all right? It's like, there should be no money that goes into this thing. So here it is. I'm just overwhelmed by all this, and so there's like nothing that I can do. It's like, I need help in this. It's like, I can't do this on my own, but I know somebody who can. Preacher Don Hardison, who was senior minister before me, he's a mechanic. And so I called Don, hey, can you come over? I think the alternator's gone out on again. I was like, can you come over? And so he would come over and I would look at all the things. You know what I'd think is, Don Hardison is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me, you know? And he's there. I was like, Don, I can't do anything. If you need a wrench, just tell me which one. I'll hand it to you. If you need me to lift something, I can do that. But I can't do this. I am powerless on my own to do this. And Don was my helper in that. And I knew that once Don showed up, that car would be fixed, okay? And so what I'm saying, what the writer of Hebrews is saying is that the Lord is our helper. We have no reason to fear, no matter what it is that we are facing. You're looking at your marriage and you're looking at the person that you've been with for years and years now, and it's not the way that you want it to be. And you're like, I am so afraid. The Lord is your helper. Do not be afraid. He is with you. He will restore your relationship if you are both willing to repent, to forgive, to move on. You look at your kids and you're like, ah, they're just going off in directions. I don't even know what to do. Or you're trying to raise them up and you're just overwhelmed. The Lord is your helper. Okay? He is there. You do not have to be afraid. You've got a difficult conversation that is coming up and you know that it's there and you're going to have it. The Lord is your helper. He will give you the words to say. You're like, I don't have the wisdom to go through this. The Lord is your helper. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask and God will give it to you. If you're struggling financially, God is your provider. He loves to take care of our kids. You can be confident in all of these situations because the Lord is our helper. I am confident because God is my helper. Can I get an amen on that one? Come on now. God is our helper. The second reason that we can be confident is I am confident is because God is with me. He is with me. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. The prophet says this, the Lord your God is, say it, he is with you. The mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. You really know that the story of the Bible is just about how God wants to be with us. In all the extraordinary lengths that he has gone to so that he could be, and we could be with him. It's about how God is for us. You know, some of us, we live our lives just believing that God is out to get us. Just waiting for us to mess up so he's just, get them. Oh, I just can't wait to pop them. And we believe that about God. We think he's just there. He's wanting to just strike us down. No, yeah, yes, God is holy. He is righteous. He will not leave any evil deed unpunished. Okay, that's true. But he is also the God who really is for us. He really does love us. And he loves us so much that he freely gave up his son to save us. He is the God who says, I am with you. I am a mighty warrior who will save you. I am with you. It's as Paul would say in Romans 8, he's like, if he's for us, who can be against us? Listen, God's not chasing you down to collect what you owe. God's chasing you down to give you what you can't afford. That's what God is doing for us. He wants to just let you know, I am with you. I love you. I am for you. And so what that means for us is that we don't have to live for his approval. No, we get to live from his approval. We don't have to live for his love. You're just thinking, oh, if I just do these things, and he's going to look down and just go, oh, you're such a good boy. Now here's a little bit of love. No, we live from his approval. He already loves us. I don't know if you all remember the tennis player Andre Agassi. You remember Andre Agassi, the picture of him up here? Just some great hair, right? Just great hair. that he lost, you know, and so it wasn't there. But he's an 8-time Grand Slam champion. He won the Olympics in 1996. He won the gold medal in tennis. Incredible tennis player. Well, in his memoir called Open, one of the things that Agassi tells us, reveals, is that his dad's love was tied to his performance on the court. And he shocked everyone in his book whenever he said, I hated playing tennis from day one until the day I retired. He's like, I always hated it. And so what drove him wasn't his love for the game. But what drove him is he was trying to win the heart of his dad. And he describes his dad as unable to tell the difference between loving me and loving tennis. See, Agassi was living for his father's approval. And it drove him. He became a champion, sure. He was miserable. Because what he really wanted was just a dad who loved him for who he was. I wonder how many of us today here are miserable. We may look like champions. We may look like success stories on the outside, but we're not living out of passion, but out of determination to try and win the love of our Heavenly Father. And you know what, friends? It's a bad view of God. It causes us to think this way. that makes us think that we've got to earn his love. Because whenever we have an accurate view of God, of who he really is, everything changes. And because we can be confident whenever we understand who God is, we can be confident because God is always with me and that he's for me. And that I don't have to live for his approval and just think that I'm going to earn this. No, I get to live from his approval. That because of Jesus and what he did, I am acceptable to God. And not based on what I do or don't do, but based off of what Jesus did. And whenever I've got a right view of God, whenever I understand that God is with me, that he is for me, that gives me confidence to take that next step that God is calling me to do. I can take it and know that he is for me. Here's my question for you. What would you do if you knew that God was absolutely for you and with you? What step would you take? Well, here's the good news. If you know the question, you know the answer. Because if you know exactly what it is that you would do if you knew God is for you, he is for you. He is with you. So you go ahead and take that step, and you just go ahead and take that step of faith. It's like, man, I want to get out of debt so I can be generous and so I can be a giver. That's what I want to do. Well, you go ahead and take that first step to start getting out of debt, and you watch what you'll see. God is for you. He wants to help you. I've got a relationship I want to restore. It's broken. It's a mess. I don't know what to do. Listen, our God hears the cry of your heart, and he wants to do what he can to soften hearts, to bring you to a healing place. He is for you. He is with you. He wants to work in your life using everything to bring about good. So you don't have to be self-confident about that. You can be God-confident of that. He is with you. He is for you. Hebrews 10:35 says this, so do not throw away your confidence. Don't throw it away. You hold on tightly and it will be richly rewarded because he is with us. He is for us. I am confident because my God is with me. Number three, I am confident because God isn't done with me. I love this one so much. I'm going to say it again. I am confident because God isn't done with me yet. Fantastic story over in the Old Testament, book of Joshua. It's in chapter 14. And just kind of give you a little bit of background going on. So Moses, you know, back in Exodus, leads the people of Israel out of Egypt, out of slavery. And God promises a promised land to them that he had promised to Abraham all those years before. And so it gets to the point to where Moses leads the Israelites out of Egypt, the 10 plagues, all the things are going on there. And they get right up to the promised land. It's time to go in. And so they send 12 spies into the promised land to see, you know, what's there and, you know, if they can do it. If you grew up in Sunday school, you remember of those 10 spies, of those 12 spies, 10 were bad and 2 were good. Do you remember that? 10 were bad and 2 were good, right? That's what it was. And so these 10 spies come back like, oh, we're like grasshoppers compared to these people. They will overtake us. We can't do this. But the two, Joshua and Caleb, they come back like, yeah, they're big, but our God's bigger. You know, we can take these guys. Well, the people get scared. They won't go in there. And so because of that, God tells that generation, you're not going to get the promised land. Y'all are going to die in the desert. Moses messes up. And so Moses gets told the same thing. Well, on that day, whenever the 10 were bad and 2 were good, whenever that took place, Moses tells Caleb, he said, hey, because of your faith, you and Joshua, you're going to get to go into the promised land. And whenever you get to the promised land, Caleb, there's some land waiting for you and your family. Okay, so that's the promise. Now, here we are in Joshua 14. We're about 45 years later or so, and this is the conversation that takes place between Joshua and Caleb. It says, now the people of Judah approached Joshua, okay, and Caleb said to him, you know what the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, at Kadesh Barnea about you and me. He says, I was 40 years old. So turn to your neighbor and say, he was a young man. Just a young man, like he was a strong man, right? Virile, very masculine, still at the top of his game. Would you guys help a 40-year-old out right now? Would you please help me out? Okay, humor me for just a second. He's like, I was 40, I was young, I was full of life, had a great head of hair, you know. That's who I was. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to explore the land. And I brought him back a report according to my convictions. But my fellow Israelites who went up with me made the hearts of the people melt in fear. I, however, followed the Lord my God wholeheartedly. So on that day, Moses swore to me, the land on which your feet have walked will be your inheritance and that of your children forever, because you have followed the Lord my God wholeheartedly. And listen to Caleb. Now then, Just as the Lord promised, he has kept me alive for 45 years since the time he said this to Moses while Israel moved about in the wilderness. So here I am today, 85 years old, and I'm still just as strong today as the day Moses set me out. I'm just as vigorous to go out to battle now as I was then. Now give me this hill country that the Lord promised me that day. You yourself heard then that the Anakites were there and their cities were large and fortified, but the Lord helping me, I will drive them out just as he said. Oh, isn't that good? Oh, I love this so much. I want to be a Caleb so desperately to just be sitting there just because you hear him. He's like, I'm 85, but I ain't dead yet, you know? And if I'm breathing, there's a reason. And if I'm dead, I'm not done. And here I am 45 years later, and I'm just as strong as I was at 40 years old. And I'm going to go in there, and I want what was promised to me. I've got fight in me. I've got courage in my veins. Let's go pick a fight. Don't you love that? It's like, give me my walker. Here we go, right? It's like, that's Caleb, and I love this just so much, and I want this for me, and I want this for you. I want this for you, for us as a church, that as our years go on, that our confidence goes up, that as the years go along, our confidence would increase in God and his faithfulness, and our courage and our bravery would be bigger than it is today. I want Paul's prayer that he prayed for the Philippians to be true for me, to be true for you, whenever he says this, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on until completion, until the day of Christ Jesus. I am confident because that God has said he's going to finish the work in me. I'm confident because God said he's going to finish the work in you. I'm confident because God said he's going to finish the work in us. He's not done with me. He's not done with you yet. I am a work in progress. You are a work in progress. We're a work in progress. And I find this just incredibly encouraging to know that that is what God says about me. And I find this incredibly discouraging because I know me. And as much as I want this to be true about me, I'm not always on the right path. Friends, I go through seasons where my growth just stalls. My discipline wanes. My mind just kind of wanders. I find myself going through the motions. Honestly, sometimes I find myself more excited about football than I do about salvation. It's just ridiculous. And I am so grateful that God's not done with me yet. That he is still working on me. He's still working in me. Even when I stumble, even when I'm distracted, even when my mind wanders, even when my strength is weak, I remain confident because he's not done with me yet. And I want you to be confident that no matter what season you find yourself in right in this very moment, maybe you're distracted, maybe you're wandering, maybe your discipline has waned, and maybe you feel weak in your own strength, God's not done with you yet. He will bring this about to a completion in you. As long as you are breathing, you still have a reason to be living this life. He's working in you. He's not done with you. I am confident today, friends. But I'm not confident. I'm not just self-confident. I'm God-confident. I'm not just confident. I'm not confident in my strength. I'm confident in his strength because he is my helper. He is with me. He is for me. He is not done with me. And you can be confident today, too, not in just yourself, but in him. Because he is your helper. You don't have to be afraid. Because he is with you. He is a mighty warrior who saves. And because he's not done with you yet. And there's still work to do for you and in you to be done. Oh God, would you please give us a confidence that is in you and you alone. And would you just develop this in ourselves. God, our spirit is willing, our flesh is weak. We want to do what's right, but we do what's wrong. sometimes, God, we're just so wrapped up in our own insecurities, uncertainties, unsure, lacking confidence because we're trying to do this all on our own. And today, God, would you please fill us with a confidence that comes from you and you alone. Father, for those of us who need to hear directly from you, I pray that you would speak in this moment. And just hear what we need to hear. Maybe, God, we just need to hear, look, I'm here to help. I'm for you. I'm not against you. Maybe we just need to hear, look, I'm not done with you yet. Don't give up on you. I haven't given up on you. Father, give us the confidence that we need in you and allow that to flow out of our lives. And we pray this in your name. Amen. I'm not confident, or I am confident, not because of what I've done, but because of what he's done. You know, oftentimes whenever it comes to our relationship with God, we begin with a feeling of insecurity. And the reason we feel insecure is because, well, we should. We're not good people. We're sinners. Our sin has separated us from God, and so our confidence cannot be in what we've done, but only in what Jesus has done. It's to put our confidence in God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ, the one that whoever we believe in, that whenever we believe in him, God gives us eternal life, that Jesus, who knew no sin, but yet God made him sin for us to make him an offering, a sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins so that we can be made right with God. We can have a confident hope that the sacrifice of Jesus is sufficient. It's enough. He's more than enough to save us. We have a confident hope in our future because of Jesus. So today, if you're feeling insecure, you can find some confidence today. You can find some certainty. But you won't find it in yourself. You will find it through him. By putting your faith in him and not in yourself. If you're ready to do that, we're going to sing a song. I'm going to be down here at the front. Our prayer partners will be as well. We'd love to pray with you, to talk with you about what that looks like. Maybe something else is going on and you just need some God confidence in your life and you just want somebody to pray with you. Now's the time to come forward for that as well. So let's stand. If there's anything at all, we invite you to come today.
Not my way, but yours be done. Not my strength, but yours alone. Nothing else, but you, oh, I found everything.
Friends, thank you so much for being here with us this morning. I hope we'll see you back here next week for part 4 of Keep It Positive. If you're a guest, we'd love a chance to say hello to you out at the guest service kiosk, so please stop on by. And then remember, if there's anything that you know you're wrestling with coming up during a song, just scares the daylights out of you, then we'd love to invite you over to the Next Steps room. Our prayer partners will be there, and they'd love to pray with you. That room is out the doors and just to your left. So we love you all very much. If you're here for a start here, we'll see you here in a little bit. But otherwise, we'll see you back here next Sunday. Let me pray over you. God, we love you, and we thank you that in you we have confidence. And so may we walk out of this place more confident than what we came in as. And may it be not in our strength, but in yours. And we pray this in your name. Amen.